Hi guys, in this video we are going to cover a very important notification which has been recently issued by the Reserve Bank of India relating to the discontinuance of letter of undertakings and letter of comforts for trade credits. Now this one gains more relevance especially in the light of recent events relating to the banking fraud which was allegedly committed by Mr. Nirav Modi. So let us start by looking at the relevance of this topic with respect to our examination. So this topic is relevant for NABARD in the ESI portion and can be linked to the subtopics reforms in banking, financial sector and current economic and social issues. And this topic can also be linked to the finance and management portion of RBI with regard to the subtopics Reserve Bank of India functions, risk management in the banking sector and the recent developments in the financial sector. So recently a notification was issued by RBI which talked about discontinuation of letter of undertakings and letter of comforts for trade credits. So this was a notification dated 13th of March 2018 and this one is important for our examination because some of the concepts which are related to this notification can be directly asked in our examination. So this notification dealt with the banks that the banks have to discontinue the use of LOUs and LOCs for trade credit. And it was felt that this was the result of a PNB fraud fallout because it was the misuse of these instruments that prompted RBI to issue this notification, probably in the Nirav Modi fiasco which was hitting the headlines recently. Now what does the notification exactly say? So this one is a very brief notification, very short notification. If you read it, you will not think that there is much in the notification. But if you go into extrapolate it, there are many important concepts for our examination which can be directly or indirectly asked in the examination. So the notification says, so we have refined the wording of the notification a little bit here. So the notification says the Reserve Bank of India has discontinued the practice of issuing letter of undertaking, that is LOUs, and letter of comforts, that is LOCs, for trade credits for imports into India by authorized dealer category 1, that is banks, with immediate effect. So the notification says that there has been a discontinuation of letter of undertakings and letter of comforts with immediate effect. So banks cannot issue these instruments with immediate effect. However, the notification further goes on to say that the letters of credit and bank guarantees, so they are other means of trade credit. Now, these means for trade credit for imports into India may continue to be issued subject to compliance with the provisions which are contained in the master circular relating to guarantees and co-acceptance issued by the Department of Banking Regulation. So, though the use of LOUs and LOCs has been discontinued, however, the banks may continue to issue letters of credit and bank guarantees for trade credits for imports into India as per the general directions of RBI in this particular regard. So if we try to understand why this move was taken by RBI, why this particular notification was issued. So the background of the notification goes back to the fraudulent use of letter of undertakings which were issued to Nirav Modi's companies between the March 2011 and May 2017. So this was the fraudulent use of these LOUs that prompted RBI to issue this particular notification to discontinue the use of letters of undertaking for trade credit. So if we look at the picture of the fiasco which took place, it was a fraud of around 11,000 crores in which the PNB Mumbai branch issued Nirav Modi illegally obtained letter of undertakings which were used in the foreign banks to obtain trade credit. We are going to understand this in a much more detail in the later parts of this particular video. But for now, we have to understand that this particular move relates to the issue of fake or fraudulent LOUs over the period of 6 years, which were the modus operandi. So this was the mode of operation of the 13,578 crore and still counting fraud which was perpetuated by the jewelers Nirav Modi and his uncle Mehul Choksi. So this was the background why this move took place, why the RBI issued the notification. So this is the end of LOU story. Now the borrowers, now the importers, whenever they need trade credit, whenever they need to import some goods, they would have to use the letter of credits or they have to use bank guarantees. Now in issuing letter of credits and the bank guarantees, the receiving bank conducts credit appraisal of the companies. So this is the receiving bank is making itself sure that the borrower or the person to whom the guarantee is issued is credit worthy. But in case of LOUs, the banks usually dependent on the issuing bank's word. So if the PNB issued LOU, the foreign bank depended on the word of PNB that okay, this person is credit worthy, this LOU is valid and can be trusted. So now the receiving bank will be itself conducting the credit appraisal, and then this may lead to increase in the cost of funding for companies, because getting LCs, that is letter of credits issued, are a bit more expensive. But on the safer side, this will make the banking system less vulnerable to fraud, because the receiving bank itself will be conducting due diligence and credit appraisal. So this RBI move will improve the bank's due diligence when it comes to trade credit. So the bank guarantees and the letter of credits, which can now be issued as per the general RBI directions, are considered less risky because the receiving bank has to conduct its own credit appraisal on the companies before accepting them. Hence, they are more secure. They are more secure, and they have the details of the purchase by the importer, date of issue, expiry date, material purchased, and other transaction details. So letter of credits are even more detailed also. So this also makes them less risky. Now in the case of now banned LOUs and LOCs, the receiving bank was entirely dependent. So this is the keyword here, entirely dependent on the bank which issued them at the behest of the importers. So now the letter of credits and the bank guarantees are going to be used, and they are going to be less risky and more secure mechanism as compared to the now banned LOUs and LOCs. So these are the different trade credit instruments which we have discussed till now. We have discussed about the letter of undertakings and letter of comforts, that how they have now been, how their use has now been discontinued. And now again, we have discussed about the letter of credits and the bank guarantees, which will now be used for the purpose of trade credits. So let us now understand, let us take a look at the different features of all these instruments in order to obtain a greater clarity regarding why this move by the RBI took place and how an important question can be framed in this relating to this in the examination, and how we can handle the same easily. So first, let's start with the letter of undertaking. Now, letter of undertaking simply serves the purpose of a bank guarantee. So letter of undertaking is simply a bank guarantee for the bank's customer for making payments to its offshore suppliers in the foreign country. So suppose if Mr. A wants to procure some material from the foreign supplier, say in US, then he will need this LOU, which will serve as a purpose of a bank guarantee. Now, once this LOU is acknowledged and accepted, the lender would be the foreign branch of the Indian bank that would transfer money to the nostro account of the bank that has issued the LOU. So the money will now be transferred to the nostro account of the bank of the Mr. A, because that bank has issued the LOU. So when an LOU is issued, the message of credit transfer is conveyed to the overseas bank through SWIFT system. SWIFT is the Society for Worldwide Interbank Financial Communication System. This SWIFT system is used for credit transfer in the overseas bank communication system. So these letter of credits are generally used for short-term credit. So now let us understand this letter of undertaking mechanism through an example. Now, letter of undertaking is quite simply similar to a letter of credit, so which is issued by one bank. So let's call it Punjab National Bank, that paves way for another bank, let's call it Allahabad Bank, to give money to supplier of Punjab National Bank's customer. So Punjab National Bank's customer is here in India and the Allahabad Bank is there abroad. So the Punjab National Bank's customer has to procure some goods from abroad, and the branch of the Allahabad Bank, which is located in that country, will transfer money to the PNB's customer via nostro account that PNB would hold in the Allahabad Bank abroad. Now, this nostro account is nothing. This account refers to an account that a bank holds in a foreign currency in another bank. So this will be the account which the PNB or the Punjab National Bank will be holding in the Allahabad Bank and abroad. So this is how the mechanism of letter of undertaking works. Now, an important reminder here is that though we are using all these terms quite similarly, for example, you may find that letter of undertaking is a letter of credit, but you may feel that letter of credit is in another terminology altogether. But we have to understand and analyze that these terms are quite interrelated and quite interlinked. And when we have to try to explain these terms, we, in order to explain in a better way, are using some synonymous terms. So you have to understand this, that what is a letter of undertaking, and you do not have to confuse it with a letter of credit, though it is similar to it, the letter of credit. Now let us understand the mechanism of issue of letter of undertaking through this particular diagram. So suppose there is an applicant who enters into a sale contract with a beneficiary who is located abroad. Now that applicant needs credit to procure some goods from the beneficiary abroad. Now in order to procure those goods, that this applicant needs some credit. So if it approaches the bank, the applicant's bank, suppose PNB. So it approaches the PNB for issuing an LOU application. So the PNB will issue this LOU in the name of the applicant, and this will be conveyed to the foreign branch of the Indian bank, say Allahabad Bank's foreign branch, through the SWIFT system. And this foreign branch will then advise the beneficiary relating to LOU, okay, that this person has issued this LOU and you may now sell goods to this particular person. And the money which is to be paid, the money of trade credit which is to be given to the person, is secured through this particular letter of undertaking. So this is how the system of letter of undertaking works. Now in this case, we have to remember that this branch, this foreign branch of the Indian bank, that is Allahabad Bank branch, is totally dependent on the credit worthiness as assessed by the Punjab National Bank. So if the Punjab National Bank is not worthy in its efforts, it has not conducted its duties properly, then this branch may also suffer due to this negligence. So this is why the use of the letter of undertaking was discontinued, because these were misused due to connivance between the officials of the banks as well as the applicants. Now let us move to the next instrument, which is the letter of comforts. Now letter of comforts in the banking parlance is referred to a document which is provided by a person. Now this person is typically an affiliate, such as the holding or the parent company of the borrower, that is the LOC provider, assuring the financial soundness of the borrower to repay its debts. So this is the technical definition. So you guys may find this definition a bit confusing. Let us understand the concept through this next example. Now suppose if SBI, State Bank of India's client, takes buyer's credit from the SBI's overseas branches, SBI will give letter of comfort, whereas if the funding is arranged from another bank, say Bank of India's overseas branch, then SBI India will give LOU. So the letter of comforts are mainly used when the funding is to be obtained from an affiliate, holding parent company, or the associate company of the LOC provider. However, LOUs are issued when the funding or the credit is to be obtained through the other bank's overseas branch. So this is the difference between the letter of comfort and the letter of undertaking. So now I suppose the concept of letter of undertaking and letter of comforts is clear to you guys. So here is an example also of the letter of comfort. So here we are having the HSBC holding, which is confirming the credit worthiness of the, his client, that is JEC International Limited here, through this letter of comfort. So now we have said goodbye to these LOUs and LOCs, letter of undertakings and letter of comforts are no more now. Both these instruments were a form of credit guarantee which were used by the importers to fund their overseas purchases, as we have just understood through our discussion till now. These were largely issued by the domestic branches of the Indian banks for customers to avail trade credit from the foreign branches of the other Indian banks, and thus ease the high cost of imports. So this is again what we have studied till now. This can be largely derived from the same. However, the RBI statement which was issued added that the banks may continue the use of letter of credits and bank guarantees for trade financing subject to compliance with the RBI guidelines. So these were the instruments which were issued till now, but now the RBI guidelines state that now you can only use these letter of credits and bank guarantees as per the RBI guidelines. So now let us understand what are these letters of credit and bank guarantees and what will be their impact on the trade scenario now. So let's start with letter of credits. Now letter of credit is simply an undertaking by a bank which is made to the seller on behalf of the buyer to pay a certain amount if documents are presented conforming to the terms of letter of credit within a stipulated time period. So it is simply an undertaking by the issuing bank which is made to the person who is selling the goods. the person who is the exporter one, who is located abroad, on the behalf of the buyer, who is the importer, to pay a certain amount if the documents are presented. So it says that, okay, Mr. Exporter, so if you transfer those goods to Mr. Importer here and you show us the documents that you have transferred those goods, we'll be making your payment. So if you conform to the terms of letter of credit within a stipulated time period, we'll be making your payment. Now, a letter of credit is simply a letter from a bank guaranteeing that the buyer will make the payment to the seller if the terms of the contract are met and the contract is honored on time and for the correct amount. So now let us try to understand the concept of letter of credit through this particular example. Now suppose there is a manufacturer who gets an order from a new customer overseas. So this manufacturer, say it is located in India, it has obtained a new order from a customer who is located in, say, another country, say US. Now this manufacturer has no way of knowing if the customer can pay, if the person is able to pay or willing to pay for the goods that they are after they are produced and shipped. So the manufacturer will be producing the goods and shipping the goods for this new customer overseas, but the manufacturer does not know whether this new customer will be paying me the money, whether the customer can pay, whether the customer is credit worthy, or even if the customer is credit worthy, whether he or she is willing to pay for the goods that will be produced and shipped. So to manage this particular risk, the seller uses an agreement. So this agreement is nothing but the letter of credit. So this agreement requires the buyer to pay with a letter of credit as soon as the shipment is made. So this letter of credit says, okay, as soon as a shipment is made, the buyer will pay the amount to the seller. So to move forward, the buyer needs to apply for a letter of credit at a local bank. So this customer who is located overseas will now approach its bank for issuing a letter of credit that, okay, this if the terms of the contract are fulfilled, the buyer will be making the payment to the seller. So the buyer may need to have funds on hand at that bank or get approval from financing for that bank. So that bank will ensure that, okay, this letter of credit is genuine and issued to a credit worthy person. And then only the bank will release funds to the seller after the seller proves that the shipment has happened. So after the seller, which is located in India, proves to the bank that, okay, this shipment has happened, then only the bank will be releasing the funds to the seller. So in this way, this the letter of credit is kind of a comfort, it kind of a surety and an assurance agreement between the buyer and seller who are not aware of each other's situation. So the seller typically provides the documents showing the how goods were shipped, like the exact dates, destination, it may be the invoices, bills or contents. So they will be showed to the bank and the bank will then honor this letter of credit and the amount will be paid to the seller of the goods. So in some ways, the buyer enjoys protection under a letter of credit. The buyer might prefer to pay a bank with a big legal department than send the money directly to the unknown seller. So this involvement of a bank through the issue of letter of credit kind of secures the entire agreement. So these are the basics of letter of credit. So we have just understood through this example that there are different parties involved in the letter of credit. So these parties involve an applicant, a beneficiary, an issuing bank, and a negotiating bank. So the applicant in a letter of credit transaction is usually the buyer or importer of goods, and the applicant of the letter of credit has to make payment if the documents as per the terms of condition of the letter of credit are delivered to the bank. So the applicant is the buyer or importer of goods who is liable to make payment once the terms of the contract are met. Next is the beneficiary. Now this beneficiary is the party to whom the letter of credit is addressed. So this is the seller or the exporter. So this beneficiary will receive the payment from the nominated bank against the submission of the documents as per the letter of credit condition. So this beneficiary is the seller or exporter who will be receiving the payment once the conditions or the documents which are required to be submitted are submitted as per the conditions in the letter of credit. Next is the issuing bank. Now issuing bank is the banker to the importer or the applicant, which lends its guarantee or credit to the transaction. Now the issuing bank is liable for payment once the documents of the as per the terms of conditions of the letter of credit are received by it from the negotiating bank. So this issuing bank is liable for making payment to the seller once the terms of the contract are honored. And then there is again a negotiating bank. This negotiating bank is nothing but the beneficiary's bank, and The beneficiary in a letter of credit transaction would be the seller or the exporter, and the negotiating bank would claim payment from the issuing bank, and then this payment will be transmitted to the seller or the exporter. So this is how the chain of the letter of credit works. These are the important parties, these are the important basic terms which are related to the letter of credit. So this is the entire working of the letter of credit, which is shown here. So let us look at it step by step. So first, there is a selling agreement between importer and exporter. So exporter will be selling goods, and the agreement is signed with the importer. Now the next step is that importer goes to the bank for issuing a letter of credit. So this letter of credit is issued then, and this letter of credit is transmitted to the bank of exporters. So this bank of exporters now later on issues this letter of credit to the exporter and says, okay, you can sell those goods, you can deliver those goods, and then the contract will be honored, and this has been effectively ensured by the bank of the importer. So the exporter goes on to complete the delivery of the goods, and the delivery of the goods is completed. Then what happens is the exporter presents these documents which ensure the delivery of the goods to the bank of exporter. So this exporter presents this document to the bank, and then this bank presents this document to the importer's bank. So now this document is presented to the importer bank, which then presents again this document and verifies it from the importer. Okay, so the entire agreement is now complete. Then what happens is the importer pays with a letter of credit, and then this payment is transferred to the bank of exporter, and ultimately this payment reaches the exporter. So this is how the entire chain or the working of letter of credit takes place. Now let us move on to the next important instrument for trade credits, which is bank guarantee. Now financial institutions usually issue bank guarantees to assist in financial transactions, and these products help the companies to mitigate credit risks when they arise. So bank guarantee is issued to the applicant for carrying out a transaction after necessary due diligence, and is always given in favor of a beneficiary which would be affected in case where the applicant fails to honor the obligations. So now it is important that we understand the difference between the two terms, that is letter of credit and the bank guarantee. So in letter of credit, once the obligation on the production of documents or the fulfillment of contract took place, the bank paid the amount to the beneficiary. However, in case of a bank guarantee, there is this slight difference, though the mechanism is almost similar. In the bank guarantee, the beneficiary is paid when there is non-fulfillment of obligation as per the contract of bank guarantee. So if the contract is not honored, if there is default on the part of the buyer, then only the bank guarantee is to be honored. So this is the difference between, this is the slight difference between the bank guarantee and trade credits, though their mechanism is almost similar. So this is how the system of a bank guarantee works. So first there is a contract between the customer and the beneficiary. So this is the exporter and customer is the importer here. So the customer goes to its bank to issue a bank guarantee. So the bank issues this guarantee, and this is conveyed to the beneficiary or the exporter's bank. And this on the basis of this bank guarantee, this bank advises the exporter, okay, now you can ship the goods, now you can export the goods, and accordingly the shipment happens. Now suppose if the payment is not made in due date, there is failure in making payment in the due date. Now what will happen? This beneficiary will tell its bank, okay, now the customer has not paid the amount, now I need the payment, so you have to encash that bank guarantee. So this customer, this exporter will be visiting its bank, and then in turn this bank will be paying a visit to the bank of the importer, bank of the customer. So now this bank will be making the payment, and this payment will be eventually transmitted to the beneficiary, and this bank will not be paying any amount from its own pocket. This bank will be eventually recovering this payment from the customer. So this is how the system of the bank guarantee works, and how it is slightly different from the system of the letter of credits. So now we have obtained a fair idea of all these trade credit instruments, and now I think we are in a situation that we can handle easily any kind of question that may be asked in examination from these trade credit instruments. So now let us also look at the impact that this particular move is expected to have on the Indian financial system, the Indian export and import system, how the exporters or importers may be affected by this particular move.
So the RBI's latest move is expected to plug the loopholes in the system, but the change in regulations may hit the import dependent business. So the first thing is that they have to come now comply with the new kind of regulations which will be there. So they will now have to reorient their business policies a bit. So this may hit the import dependent business in the short term. For instance, their cost of financing may go up. So now, because they may have to now depend on the letter of credits and the bank guarantees, for which the banks have to carry proper due diligence and credit worthiness. So banks may start charging more amount for these kinds of instruments. So the cost of financing of the importers may be affected. Also, the business risk for importers may go up because they will now need higher finance limit for banks. But the banks, which are already reeling under the pressure of the biggest banking frauds and piling up of non-performing assets, are unlikely to be as generous as they were in the past. Now, earlier the banks used to issue these kinds of instruments on more easier terms, but now with the more piling up of NPAs and the banking frauds which are gaining prevalence, the banks are likely to be more cautious and they are likely to carry out more different kinds of credit worthiness checking systems they are going to have. So it may impact the importer. The importer may have to shell out more money for obtaining these kinds of credit instruments from the bank. Some also believe that these LOUs were generally used by the large players in the gems and jewelry sector only, and these letter of credits and bank guarantees will now continue to be available. So this RBI's latest ban will only have a little impact on trade. So this is also the view of some of the experts in the market. However, only time will tell the exact impact that this move will have on the Indian financial or the Indian trade scenario.
Now let us look at some very important MCQs which can be framed from this particular portion in examination. So first question, as per the latest circular issued by RBI, issuance of which of the following instruments has been discontinued for trade credits for imports into India by authorized dealer category 1 banks? Options are letter of undertakings, letter of comforts, letter of credits, or both A and B. So this we have seen that the latest move of the RBI as per the notification issued on the 13th of March 2018 bans the use of, discontinues the use of letter of undertakings and letter of comforts. So here answer would be option number D, that is both A and B. Next question, bank guarantees and the letter of credits are considered less risky as compared to the letter of undertakings and letter of comfort, as options are receiving banks have to conduct their own credit appraisal before accepting them. They are secured by a fixed charge on tangible fixed assets of the company. They can never be dishonored, or none of the above. So this we have seen that in case of bank guarantees and letter of credit, they are more secure and they are less risky as compared to LOUs and LOCs because the receiving banks conduct their own credit appraisal and due diligence before accepting them. So here answer would be option number A. Next question. Once the letter of undertaking is acknowledged and accepted, the lender bank transfers money to the dash account of the bank that has issued the LOU. Options are Loro, Nostro, Vostro, or none of the above. So this again we have discussed in detail that in case of the acknowledgement of the letter of undertaking, the lender bank transfers the money to the Nostro account of the bank that has issued the LOU. So here answer would be option number B. Nostro. Next question. Dash in the banking parlance is a document provided by an affiliate of the borrower, the facility provider, assuring the financial soundness of the borrower to repay its debts. So we are being asked about the instrument which is provided by an affiliate of the facility provider, assuring the financial soundness of the borrower. The options are letter of undertaking, letter of credit, letter of comforts, or none of the above. So this we have seen that in the letter of comforts, there is a document which is provided by an affiliate. So the letter of comfort was being provided by the SBI's Indian branch to the SBI's overseas branch, assuring the financial soundness of the borrower. So this option number C would be the correct answer here. Next question. Dash is the banker to the importer or buyer, which lends its guarantee or credit to the letter of credit transaction. So we have discussed about all the important components, all the basic components of the letter of credit transaction, and we understood that there were four components which included the applicant, which is the importer, the beneficiary, which is the exporter, the issuing bank, which is the bank of the importer, and the negotiating bank, which is the bank of the exporter. So here we are being asked about the banker to the importer or buyer. So this will be the issuing bank. So here answer would be option number C, issuing bank. Other options were applicant, beneficiary and negotiating bank. But the answer would be option number C, issuing bank. So these are the answers. So guys, this was all about the recent RBI notification relating to discontinuance of letter of undertakings and letter of comforts for trade credits. Thank you.